So I'm going to start now with my presentation on energy. Energy, which is at the heart of the fight against climate change and the promotion of sustainable development. Energy is fundamental to human life. Energy is central to all our activities, from making food, heating, light, transportation. So supplying energy means contributing to the economic and social development and the well-being of all people on the planet. Energy is also at the heart of one of the greatest challenges of the 21st century, saving the planet from the threat of climate change while enabling humanity to escape poverty. Climate change is a reality, and all society need to be part of the response, that is to say industry, policymakers or government, and also consumers. The energy and climate challenge are inseparable from other major world challenges such as poverty, hunger, environmental degradation, biodiversity loss, preservation of water, ethics and corruption. The UN Sustainable Development Goals have set a path to the responsible creation of a better future that is more sustainable for everyone. It's not enough to decarbonize energy, it's also necessary to meet the growing energy needs of a rising global population in a responsible way. That is the dual challenge for energy. As you can see on this chart, I'll explain a bit about the graph after, but there are 7.7 billion people in the world today, and more than 1 billion people do not have access to energy today. And in 2050, we should be approximately 10 billion people on the planet, and this demographic growth and the improvement of living standards will require energy that is reliable, affordable, clean, and accessible to as many people as possible. This means reinventing energy. This is looking, in fact, at the past in relation to GDP and associated energy need, and with the energy, the emissions that are coming today with the energy. And of course, there is immediately the evidence of the climate challenge on this slide. Demography is a very predictable science in terms of numbers. So we know that world population will grow, and therefore the need for energy is going to grow at the same time. I think that this slide illustrates the challenge to have a growing world population and GDP, and therefore a growing energy need for energy, and therefore greenhouse gas emissions. So reinventing energy means promoting renewable decarbonized energies. This is solar, wind power, biofuels, biogas, hydrogen. Reinventing energy also means reducing the emissions generated by the production of fossil energies and storing the residual carbon. Reinventing energy means that the market will have to change the way we use energy, focusing on energy efficiency and preferring renewable or decarbonized energies. Reinventing energy concerns all of society, governments, investors, business and consumers. All of them have a role to play. So in fact, last Tuesday, Total Energies presented a new energy outlook. We do this every year. And in this new energy outlook, we have essentially two scenarios looking towards 2050. They are called momentum and rupture. Both of them assumes a 3% growth per year of GDP, but the associated growth of energy demand is not the same. In the momentum scenario, we have an assumption that the growth of energy demand will only be 0.5% per year. That implies that there is a lot of energy optimization in terms of the way we use energy. And for rupture, it's even less. It's only 0.3% per year in the rupture scenario. So the first momentum scenario, and you will see why I explain this, assumes that all of the net zero 2050 countries, that countries that have made commitments under the Paris Agreement to be net zero by 2050, will deliver their commitments. And also that China will be on track to achieve carbon neutrality by 2060. Under that scenario, the temperature will still rise to more than 2 degrees, it says 2.2 to 2.4 degrees C, by the end of the century. But for example, this scenario, if you translate it into concrete policy measures, mean that by 2035, there will not be in the net zero 2050 countries thermal engines. So all vehicles will be running on electricity. So it's a very strong underlying hypothesis, just to take one of them. In the second one, the rupture scenario, it's even more disruptive because to get to that level, we need to have all of the non-net zero countries to change drastically their policies so that they are more or less in line with the net zero 2050 countries. And it also implies some, I would say, significant technological breakthroughs in terms of the way we use energy and energy efficiencies, and I would say globally, a rebuilding of the energy systems. In that scenario, from our simulation, the temperature increase would be less than 2 degrees, but would still be above the 1.5 degrees C, that is the target of many policymakers. So in fact, those slide is just an illustration through our scenario. It's, of course, none of them is correct. It's not there to predict the future, but try to anticipate what could happen to derive some policies. So I would like to, in a simplistic way, because our presentation had 50 slides, so I extracted only a few, to show you the path, in fact, to transforming energy, which I believe is important for you to understand and, in fact, to open the debate about the levers we have as an industry to transform this energy industry. First is to acknowledge the fact that in all scenarios, there will be more energy needed in the future. We also see that oil demand will plateau somewhere after 2030 and then will decline. Gas is an enabler of the energy transition, both in power and in industry. Development of greener liquid and gas as fuel is going to be an important contributor, but also radical electrification with storage capabilities. Of course, renewable decarbonizing the power sector, that is to say, massive generation of electricity using wind and solar power. Hydrogen, increasingly penetrating industry and transportation. And last but not least, carbon sinks. This is what we call carbon capture and storage, but also natural-based solution. Carbon sink will help to match the gap of the energy that, or the carbon emission that will not be avoided. So that was, in a, again, simplistic way, our vision of the pathway to the energy transition. If we do all this, and this will be my last slide, because I don't want to dwell too much onto this, and I'm sure there will be questions, you see the evolution of the primary energy demand in 2050, compared to 2019, that is on the left of the slide, in the two scenarios we have envisaged for 2050, the momentum and the rupture. And without making a very detailed analysis, you see on the right part of the slide how, in fact, looking at 2019 primary energy demand and how it evolves to 2050, the contributing role of net zero 2050 countries that will reduce, in fact, their energy consumption over the period while growing their economy. So it means that there's an underlying hypothesis on very good energy efficiency. But you see the rest of the world, of course, a different scenario depending on how much energy they will need for the future between the momentum and the rupture. What is important to note is that the energy demand will change significantly by 2050. If you look at the mix of primary energy. But what you can see is under both scenarios, the rupture and the momentum, which are already themselves quite, I would say, not extreme, but not simple scenario to realize, natural gas will grow. In the momentum, you see that fossil energy continue to supply more than 50% of the primary energy demand. And you can also see that coal has almost disappeared in the rupture scenario. Solar and wind, of course, are growing very significantly. So I will not dwell more on this energy outlook. However, key takeaways is that first, energy transition implies major shift in energy mix and the use of energy. Second takeaway is that fossil fuel is still required, like the nuclear, by the way, as you can see. And third, of course, that is not mentioned on the slide, but there are underlying cost implications, the cost of energy for this transition, which we want to be a just transition. How do we share the cost of this decarbonized energy? And of course, that's one of the main challenges of the COP26 that is going to take place next month. So with that, I would like to, if I can find my papers, share with you the way Total Energies, as one of the of major actors, of course, in the field of energy, our ambition to be the company of responsible energy. Energy represents the history of Total as a company, but also the future of Total Energies. Total Energies, so we changed our name last June, is a major energy player today, and we want to be also a major energy player tomorrow. We support the goal of the 2015 Paris Agreement, which calls for reducing greenhouse gas in the context of sustainable development and the fight against poverty, and which aims to limit the increase of global temperature below 2 degrees C compared to pre-industrial levels. We say 2 degrees C and nothing else for the reason I've just explained. Total Energies declared its ambition to get to net zero across its production and energy products, that's scope 1, 2, and 3, for those who are familiar with this jargon, so used by its customer by 2050, together with society. It's important to say together with society because, there again, it's not just Total Energies that defines which products are being consumed. Total Energies has embedded the changing energy mix into its strategy by investing in renewables and electricity, favoring the use of natural gas in addition to hydrogen and biomass, targeting investments in low-cost oil and biofuels, and by developing nature-based carbon storage solutions as well as CO2 capture and sequestration. This ambition means profitable investment in order to be one of the top 5 producers of renewable energy, to make renewable energy a profitable business. Deployment across the entire electricity value chain from production to the end user. This involves also storage and trading. To have a responsible approach on fossil energies, focusing on value by selecting low-cost development that are the most efficient in terms of greenhouse gas emission, producing also more green gases and green fuels. We believe that there is a lot to do in this region in particular, and this is why we are developing a lot of projects in Abu Dhabi, but also in the region. We want to reach the top 3 in low-carbon LNG. We want to become a leader in mass production of clean hydrogen, using a similar model as the one we had with LNG, so it's massive production of clean hydrogen. The challenge here being, of course, that today there is not a lot of customers, there is not a lot of use of hydrogen, so we need to develop that market as well. We want to become a partner of our customers in their carbon neutrality journey. We want to be an important actor of electrical mobility, as we are today in the distribution of fuel. This is, the network, the petrol station network. We are promoting circular economy in the use of plastics, developing carbon storage, and being a recognized leader in sustainable development. All of this is linked together. So the decade 2020-2030 will see Total Energies transformed itself into a true broad energy company. Total Energies projected production and sales mix will change significantly by 2030. And just to give you some rough figures, today, Total Energies is producing 50% oil, 50% gas, 3 million barrels of oil equivalent per day. And by 2030, 10 years from now, we shall be producing 4 million barrels of oil equivalent per day, so that's a plus 30% increase, responding to the growing energy demand, but with a different mix, because 50% will be coming from gas and green gases, 35% from oil and liquid biofuels, and 15% from electricity, of course, mostly from renewable. So this is actually a growth of energy proposal, but with, of course, a very different mix in line with the scenario that we have presented, and also in line with the objective, of course, of the 2050 net zero target. We are investing approximately half of our $13 to $15 billion per year of annual capital budget into low-carbon energies. Total Energies is also committed to the Sustainable Development Goal of the UN with four main axes. Sustainable energy, which means leading the transformation of the energy model to combat climate change and respond to people's needs. The well-being of people, being a leading name as an employer and a responsible operator. Environmental excellence, this means being exemplary in terms of environmental management and using the planet's natural resources. It's essentially being very efficient in the use of our own energy, the energy we need to produce. Creating value for society, generating shared prosperity across regions, creating positive changes for community and in host regions where we produce energy. Total Energies recognize a positive role of a permanent commitment and open dialogue with investors, but also other economic actors like government, society, NGOs. Total Energies reports in line with the Sustainability Accounting Standard Boards and support the World Economic Forum initiative advocating shared ESG indicators for all companies. Each year, Total Energies publishes a climate report with a detailed progress on how we are progressing on our targets. So it's a transparent reporting on the commitment we take. So as a conclusion, let me tell you that myself, I've spent 40 years with the company. I'm very passionate about the ongoing transformation of the company and our contribution to responding to one of the greatest challenges of our century. Thank you.